here, a person who is an asylee, and that's a person who has been granted asylum, an asylee, that person can then apply for a green card. And then further down, that person will be able to apply for citizenship. We have a couple of, I think it's this week, Connie and Robert are going to have their naturalization interview, and they came in as Indonesians about 15 years ago, and they were Chinese Indonesians. It was based on a combination of religion and ethnic group, and they acquired asylum. And then they applied for their green card, and 15 years later now, they're getting ready to be naturalized. So there are, asylum is our commitment, our American commitment to international human rights. And that's really what asylum relations is about. So how many of you know what your ethnic background is? So let's see. So how many of you are first generation Americans? So that means the rest of you like came over like in the boat sometime in the 1840s, 1850s. Well, your ancestors did? Pretty much. 1880s? What's your ethnic background?
Half Italian, half Eastern European, Mongol.
Mongol. That's what Americans are. We're like, you know, what you pick up in the local humane society. We're mutts. Well, we are. Think about that. How many of us are? I mean, I'm half Finnish on my father's side. I'm Finnish. My dad was a first generation American there. And on my mother's side, they've been here since, you know, before the revolution, and it was Scotch and Irish. And that's, you know, it's sort of like, and that's a blend. I mean, most Americans are blended. Most of us are blended. There's, you know, and there's certain ethnic groups that blend more easily than others, and historically have blended more easily than others. How many of you speak a second language? Very few.
Third language?
You know the old joke about what you call a person who speaks three languages, right?
American.
No, trilingual. And a person who speaks two languages is a bilingual. A person who only speaks one language is called an American. Problem is that that's so funny. It's really important to have, speaking a language gives you an insight into how another culture thinks, how another culture responds. So where are your placements? Tell me about your placements.
Well,
I see the shirt. Okay. Anybody working for a state senator or state assemblyman? Okay.
Kind of the campaign. It's like me and Jess are in Somerset County Democrats, so we're working on like a whole bunch of campaigns.
So you're working out of Trenton?
Working out of Manville, is where our headquarters is.
Okay. Anybody working for, what else? Where else are you in place? Anybody working for a member of Congress? Which school? I'm sorry?
Congressman Palum.
He's my congressman. I live in Plainfield. And same person. He's really good on environmental issues. He's really known for that. And anybody working for?
Law firms?
Ah.
Everybody else. You all want to be lawyers.
You all want to be lawyers. No. There are many ways to be lawyers. Good ways and bad ways. Don't become a lawyer if you put in the law. That's not the reason you go into law. That's not the reason. You know, that wonderful quote from Shakespeare, first kill all the lawyers. Do you know what that's from? That's a very, very important quote. I mean, it's always taken out of context. It's from Henry VI, Part 2. And it's when Jack Cade is talking about how they're going to take over the government. First, we're going to kill all the lawyers. That's how you destroy something. Because law is the very foundation of how it is that we function as a society. And it's a very important foundation. I'm really committed to law. And the reason I'm really committed to being a lawyer is because my grandfather, my father's father, came here because where he lived, he couldn't make change. I mean, he was living in Finland under the Russian occupation before World War I. And yes, I'm that old. Before World War I. So he couldn't make change in this country. He came here. I can make change here, and every single one of you can make change here. The question is how organized you're going to be in doing that, and how committed you're going to be to make law an instrument of social change, because that's what's really important. Because if the law doesn't change society, then there's chaos. There really is chaos. Well, that's my lecture for tonight.
Well, I have a problem with you.
I know. You should. We know each other a long time. You always have a problem.
It was a problem for her, and she has a problem with me too. The
problem I have with you is you're helping people who have no money.
Yeah, there's a fair amount of truth to that. That's
yeah.
True.
So, how do you do it?
We charge a lot of things. We charge very low fees.
Okay.
And and I don't earn that much, but we charge very low fees and. I am and we use our resources well.
Do you get grants from anybody?
We don't get government grants. We have some help from churches and from faith groups. So that's how we get some. That's how we get some support.
Now I have a question.
And there are people that we don't charge at all because they just they don't have 2 cents to rub together.
Saturday I was in Princeton for a conference. And I heard a presentation from a Baptist minister from Elizabeth who told us a story. And she said that she got a phone call a few years ago asking if she could host an ESL class. You may figure out what you're talking about. I don't remember her name, but you may figure it out given what you know of the community. And she said, sure. And all of a sudden, 25 people showed up, and she was the teacher. These were refugees from Burma.
I know exactly.
I thought you might figure it out. And she ended up being the landing point for 6 months to 2 years for groups of Burmese refugees. And I'm wondering why they started in Elizabeth and why they would have turned to that particular church for help.
Okay, what happened with that particular group is the Burmese refugees are here because they belong to a particular ethnic group, and they're Khatuns, and Khatuns are primarily Christian, and which is very unusual for Burma. It's not primarily a Christian society, and it's the same way any immigrant community grows. Somebody comes in and plants themselves, and then they just sort of start to expand a little. Expanded level, and you know that this person came here and that person came here, and that's how the ethnic community grew. And they attached themselves to that particular Baptist church because the first person who came happened to have been a Baptist and looked for a church in the community where she was placed, and that's how she ended up there, and that's how First Baptist ended up with all these Burmese refugees. Now, let me explain the difference between an asylee and a refugee. These people who came in from Burma came in as already admitted refugees. That means they were actually processed for their protection overseas. They were processed by an organization called IOM, International Organization of Migration. And that particular organization interviews people who may be refugees and then brings them into the United States, and they actually come in with a certain kind of stipend. They come in with stipends from governmental sources and faith-based sources. We actually have a line item in our federal budget for refugee assistance, and every state actually has an office of what's called Office of Refugee Resettlement, and New Jersey has one just as every other state has one. And in this particular group, there happened to be the Burmese happened to be located there, and they were very anxious to learn English, and most of them have learned English, and they got their residence, and many of them are now citizens, and are contributing to the society. They're really an interesting group of people, because I've done some work with some of the people. Some of them have housing problems. Their customs are different. They adjusting to a new society. Try to imagine yourself being dumped into a country where you don't speak the language, the customs are totally different, the law is like something that you don't understand, like why people behave the way they do. And your children are going to a school and you can't communicate with the teacher because you don't speak enough of whatever that language is. And imagine what it would feel like. I mean, that's how most immigrants feel in this society until they become acclimated enough to learn English, to be able to adjust and change, and especially refugees who have also gone through enormous amount of trauma. I mean, you're thinking about people who, in this particular group of Burmese refugees, they had seen entire villages slaughtered. I mean, slaughtered. And when you talk to some people, you're wondering, why do we sound so disjointed? I mean, when I talk to some of my they came in as Indonesians about 15 years ago, and they were Chinese Indonesians. It was based on a combination of religion and ethnic group, and they acquired asylum. And when they applied for their green card, a person who was an asylee, and that's a person who has been granted asylum, an asylee, that person can then apply for a green card. And then further down, that person will be able to apply for citizenship. We have a couple of, I think it's this week, Connie and Robert are going to have their naturalization interview, and they've been card, and 15 years later now, they're getting ready to be naturalized. So there are, asylum is our commitment, our American commitment to international human rights. And that's really what asylum is about. So how many of you know what your ethnic background is? So let's see. So how many of you are first